This song I'm going to sing, my sister wrote this. Where is Michelle? Is she? Where? Yeah, hello. Here you are. Michelle. Anyway, she played this song at a concert when she got engaged to... Anyway, we're going to sing it. We changed the words a little bit. But we're going to sing it because I love it. And I love it. I hear my mother's laugh.
Yeah.
Where is your boat?
Where is your boat?
Where is his boat?
Just got off the roof.
Where is his boat?
Pick a spot along the flyway. I know that you are mine. I do know all the words to all these songs. And that's that. This is a song that a guy named Mark Cohn wrote to his unborn baby. Don't know much about you. Don't know who you are. We were doing fine without you. We can only go so far. Don't know why you chose us. Were you watching from above? Was there someone there that knows us? Said we'd give you all our love.
I must have you, or I am broken.
really an angel?
Listen.
Barry. Not on this song, man. Come on. We will take a moment, just a moment. How's that coffee? Hazelnut? Irish cream.
He never was.
I don't know if you can help me, sir, bro. Barry told you this morning.
Uh-oh. We're talking about
it.
You gotta know this.
Okay. How many Baptists does it take to change a light bulb?
Wait a minute.
Change? Man, that kid crossed my line right there. This song is called Sovereign.
Yeah.
It was soon. The last song we're going to do is called Writing to You, and it is a, I think it's a song that tries to describe the state of being of a person who is seeking to justify him or herself before God and is failing to see that it's God who justifies that person. And so that's what this song is about. I'm writing to you from a prison cell on my deathbed. Thank you. That's it. Little cake and coffee. Michelle and Barry will come up here shortly. There's the Reverend. All right.
Somewhere downtown, up on the G-Guys.
Sweet 6 months, and this time when I pulled into town, I felt like, yeah, this place is a part of me now, and of all of us now. My kids came to church on Wednesday night, and were just so loved on and excited to be back and see all their buds. So thanks. Thanks for letting us do this, and thanks to everybody who made the atmosphere possible. This is not...
Thank you.
Juniper Lou, and we play under that name in bars and coffee shops and colleges and more public venues, and it has been an adventure. And so the first part of the set is stuff from that project, which, as the recording process goes, did not get finished in time to be here tonight, but is due to be delivered on Monday. So I got this awesome Sweet Home Alabama.
Wrong.
What? The Monday after Thanksgiving. So I've got a Sweet Home Alabama CD deal for you tonight. And here comes my commercial. You ready?
But wait, there's more!
Give a sermon one time about that the worst possible scenario for your heart and your life would be for God to lift his presence from you. That would pretty much be the definition of hell, to be out of God's presence. So, that's what this song is about, and it's big hit in bars. Song, and she said, "Man, thank you for singing that song about the guy who left his wife and kids, because my dad did that to me, and he's a so-and-so, and I was like, wow, you know, this girl in the back alley is just giving it to me, you know? I was like, oh, I'm so sorry that happened to you. Thanks for telling me. And she just kind of left. And as she left, I realized that I knew her, that when I worked at a Catholic school after school care program, she was in my six-year-old class, and I knew her well because she was one that arrived early, like 6:30 in the morning, and stayed late, and even got forgotten one time. We had to like order pizza for her because there was some sort of mix-up with the family, forgot to pick up their kid. So I knew her well, and I was very surprised to realize that was her, so I sent Barry after her. He tracked her down, and she was shocked to see it was Miss Michelle. And we spent the next 45 minutes just getting down and dirty about what was going on in her life, because she'd already opened her heart up to me as a complete stranger and already told me the biggest heartache in her life. So once she realized that she knew me, how much more she was open to let me in. So I just kind of took it as a divine opportunity and just spoke the truth, got her email, and I'm still sending truth to her because I love her. And here goes the PMS email. Anyways, that was a stellar night for us in realization that God has a plot at all times, and He is ordaining every step for each one of us. And if I can intersect somebody along their way and speak some truth to their heart, then my life is worth it. I got stoked. Let's sing. This song is upset. It's good for anger, so this will make me not cry. Maybe you should do the talking.
Say, listen.
I think that, can you relate to that on some level? Hopefully not you guys, but as adults, can you relate to that, at least not from a firsthand thing necessarily, but do you know somebody that's going through something like that? Like Michelle said, the guy pretty much wrote the song himself, because these are all a lot of quotes, almost verbatim, some of them. And, you want to vent some anger. Somebody needs to cry foul, every once in a while. When a guy just decides to walk out on his kids and really doesn't have anything else to say to them for the rest of their lives, and doesn't want anything else to say to them. And I think, it should be fairly easy for us to identify right and wrong. And I totally understand we're broken people, and broken relationships are a fact in our society and in our lives and in our churches. So I'm not trying to dog anybody for having marital problems. That's not what I'm saying. But I think it should be fairly easy for us to say, that is not right. That's wrong. And if you think about just the world at large, turn on CNN or Fox News and watch what's going on. That's me. Watch what's happening every day. Think about what's happened in the last 5 years, the last 10 years, the last century. I'm not talking about ancient history. You think about the atrocities and the black, black evil that comes out of us. We're flawed people. It'd be really, really cool if the philosophy that man is inherently good, we're all really good at heart, were true, and I believe that there is good in us. I believe that we are all created in the image of God, and we have the capacity for good. But I also see, when I look at my own heart, there's blackness there, there's need there. And I'm not perfect. I'm a selfish creature in need of redemption. And that's what this next song is about. It's called Wicked Eyes. And just talking about our need for a Redeemer.
Thank you.
song, and the guy that did the graphic art for our first, he's done the graphic art for pretty much all of our songs. He's not your typical graphic artist. I think Dad's met him before. He's about 300 pounds, big, burly guy. Talks like this a lot. He's a close talker. Gets right in your face. You know what I'm talking about? Quite a while back, he heard me do this song, and it's like he just fell in love with it. I'm thankful for that. Somebody likes it, but it's like he would come to any place that we were playing, whether it was appropriate or not. And if we didn't play that song, he would start yelling and saying the strangest things. The name of the song is Skin. And he'd start yelling, "Man, my skin itches!" In the middle of a public place.
Why are we doing it tonight?
I don't know. It's kind of bringing back warm, fuzzy memories of me. So this is Skin.
These last two were killers.
We'll be right back.
As this darkness in the room.
to be a part of another recording this summer, that the End of Worship Circle 3 recording. Really, really cool experience, really hard in a good way. We just were really aware of a lot of opposition. And but the Lord was very, very, very gracious. And we knew it was Him. The recording would not have gotten done if it hadn't been for Him. We went way off in the middle of nowhere. You know, we live in the edge of nowhere, and we drove about 4 hours to get to nowhere. After the first song that we recorded, the recording system that we were using completely broke down. Just like the computer died. Not like crashed, it died, it wouldn't come on. But just by fluke, we had another recording. I mean, you know, you don't normally take around two entirely complete recording systems, but we did. And so we threw that together real fast, and the rest of the recording happened. So, I don't know, we're really excited about it. It's just come out. It was a neat experience for us. I remember that we did, with Karen and the youth and some other folks here, a songwriting workshop one time a while back. We were talking about writing out a song. And that's the whole idea behind this recording, is to take the psalms, daily meditations in the psalms, and try to put them into song, you know, give voice to certain things. Bye, guys. Thanks for coming. Yeah, thank you for coming. Bye. So we're going to do a couple of songs from that recording. This one is from Psalms 109. It's called Everlasting Love. Can I say, I got to tell these guys what the working title was. Because we did a songwriting workshop. It's educational once again. Well, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I'm just a crass individual. When I started writing music to the song, you know, that little thing there, I couldn't think of what the song was about or what to say. And so my working title, what I was singing for a while, was Bloody Freaking Dog. Sorry, I don't mean to correct you. Just how it started.
Thank you.
circle to see if they would let it in, and it's a few years old. It's just about the sovereignty of God. Do they sing it here? You sing God is good here?
Yeah.
You do? Okay, so you know that song. So we submitted it, and we're all happy that they liked it, and we're going to get to do it. And then a couple of weeks before we went to record it, a friend of our family, probably if you know Darren, you know this, a good friend of Darren's and also a dear friend of mine, lost his 4 months, was she 4 months old? 4 month old baby girl who had pulmonary disorders, many pulmonary problems. And so Darren sang this song at her funeral, and it just says over and over again, God is good, God is good, God is good, God is good. But that song had a whole new meaning to me by the time I got to the recording. It was like, in the face of a friend who lost a baby, is God still good? And yes, he is. And so I would rather sing with passion than without, so I thought I would tell everybody that what that song meant to me right before we went to record it, and I did, and of course there's tons of girls there, so lots of snot and tears and flowed when we sang this song, but we sang it as intercession for our friends Dave and Tanya, and so when you go back there and buy that CD and take it home, or I deliver it to you, you'll hear the passion with which we sung that song. Is that okay?
Thank you.
to give you praise. Psalm 68 says he sends showers of abundance to refresh his weary inheritance. And I'm kind of feeling weary, you know, lately. We've been gone from the house for a while. I kind of need some refreshing. And the cool thing is that the Lord delights to do that for us, you know? And so if that's you, you know, if you're in that weary place and you need some refreshment, let's just believe the word of the Lord. He sends showers of refreshing, of abundance, pardon me, to refresh his weary inheritance. So let's just kind of remind ourselves of that, that that's the Lord's heart. And let's sing this to him, and then we're going to sing one more song along the same theme from Psalm 36 in just a second. And we'll be done. Lord, it's my joy.
It's my joy. It's my joy.
Continue to love me with that same love.
I was surprised.